morning and welcome to Calvary Bible Church. We're so glad you're here today. I only have one announcement before we get started in our worship today, and that is to remember that next Sunday evening, we start our Sunday evening class, Big Picture Bible, and we're really excited about that, and we'd really like everyone to come out. We're going to start these upcoming classes, perhaps once a quarter, maybe three times a year, and we want the church to become more equipped to use their scriptures, but not just in knowledge. We're also hoping that it will have an effect of spiritual transformation for each individual, and that spiritual transformation will also be able to be used to help disciple others. So we're hoping for that chain effect to happen. So Big Picture Bible is the first one we're offering next Sunday evening, and it starts at 5:30. Otherwise, let's start our worship this morning with a call to worship, a verse from the Bible, and then we'll meditate for a moment, and then Pastor Lee will come up in prayer to get our service started. The call to worship today comes from Psalm 95. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand.
Dear Heavenly Father, it is indeed good to come before you in prayer, to come into your house. It is good for your people who are called by your name to gather around your word, to listen carefully to all that you have to say, and to come and say that we love you, that we desire with all of our heart to serve you, and that we want very much that we do and say to be pleasing in your sight. So, Lord, we offer up these prayers of thanksgiving. We offer up these prayers of exaltation. And we ask you to bless us and to fill us with your Holy Spirit as we come to worship. Lord, we also come with a humble heart. We do not come before you presumptuously. We do not come before you without first confessing our sins and asking you to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, we lend our voices to that of King David, who cried out to you and said, "Search me and know me, O God, and if there is any unclean, bring it to my attention that I might confess it and repent from it this very hour." Lord, we ask you to forgive us because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, that atoning death, the death that calmed and soothed your righteous anger, a death that was not for his own sins, but was for ours. So because of Christ Jesus, Lord, we know that through faith, we have been made new again. And so this morning we come and humbly ask you to forgive us. Lord, we also pray this morning for spiritual growth. Lord, we ask that you would grow us both in knowledge and love, that you would grow us in devotion, that you would grow each one of us in the development of our spiritual gift, that we might serve others, that you would grow each of us in boldness, that we might speak the truth in love. And to those whom you are calling to yourself, we will be a clear voice, crying out, be saved. Come to the cross and be made new again. Lord, we pray this especially as September is now here, and next Sunday we will gather on Sunday night for our next discipleship class workshop. And on the 22nd of this month, we start to gather for the first time for our action teams. And so we ask your blessing. But we pray for the outcome of these gatherings, that they might yield great purposes to your glory. They might yield ministries we have not yet even thought of. They might yield plans that we have not yet devised as we come together as one body, each serving the other and doing so to your glory. So this morning, Lord, we pray for spiritual growth. And now, Lord, as we continue in worship, as we look forward to singing together and studying your word together and enjoying the Lord's table together, we just ask that you would again bless us, fill us with your Holy Spirit, and may all that we do and say be a sweet aroma to you in heaven. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm going to invite John Bolthouse to join me here. Dale and Lisa Lee are gone this weekend. It's their anniversary, by the way, and that's why they're out. And so Keaton is also on the road, which means that instead of getting me directing the music, so John is going to lead us in glorious things of thee are spoken. There is a fountain, and beneath the cross of Jesus. Then Ed is going to pray, and then I'm going to come and lead us in more precious than silver right before the sermon. So John, come and lead us in these hymns. We're looking forward to. Let's stand together and sing hymn 278.
I pray for the church, I thought that I'd share my prayer time with another pastor, Apostle Paul, as he prayed for a church in Ephesians. So our first half of the prayer will be from Apostle Paul, and then I'll break into prayer. Let's listen to how Paul prayed for the Ephesian church in chapter 3. He says, "For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and on earth is named, that he would grant to you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length, depth, height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever." And let's continue to pray for our church as well. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to say amen to how the Apostle Paul preached. I too, as a pastor, desire that our congregation will be filled with all the fullness of God, and that they would be rooted and grounded in faith. And I pray, Lord, as we come before your throne today, that we realize that you are glorified through the church, not the building, but through the people. We come together, grow together, reach out together into our communities. As we live together as one, we can bring great glory unto your name. And this dark and dying world needs to see that light that shines through us. So I pray, Lord, that we'll be diligent to let our light shine this week. Lord, we also want to thank you for the many needs in our church. We know that as a congregation, we have many needs, and we want to pray for those needs. I think of a few this morning, Lord, that are on our list. We think of Dean as he is now getting his new meds as he fights his long-haul COVID issues, Lord. We pray, Lord, that Fritz Mars might find some relief in these medicines. We pray, Lord, that Dean's body will take these medicines and start a turnaround here somewhere so he can start to get some initial functions back that are lost. We also want to pray for his wife, Karen, as she's been working on her own physical issues. And she's very busy running the household currently while Dean's down. So we ask, Lord, for her body to be touched as well and to continue to strengthen, to be healed. We want to thank you for Jim Wagemaker going through shoulder surgery. As I talked to him this last Tuesday, he said it was supposed to be successful, but now he's dealing with the pain of recovery after surgery. So we ask, Lord, that you'll be close to him and allow him a good time of healing, that he'll get much of that shoulder back and be able to function again and just be able to serve you, Lord. He loves to work with his hands and be able to serve you with his hands once again. And Lord, finally today, I want us just to be reminded of why we are here today. As we come before your throne, we all want to bow the knee. For we know that you are that great and mighty and awesome God. You are infinite. So we are a mere beggars as we come before your throne. But as your scriptures tell us that you love us, even in this condition. So we're so thankful this morning. So we come here having a mighty awe at who you are and how you reach down and touch our lives. So we want to worship you and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So before we study together, let's stand one more time and sing twice. Sing twice the chorus, "More Precious Than Silver." Let's stand together.
as you are getting comfortable, I hope you will take out your Bible, take out today's sermon notes, and join me in the book of Colossians, chapter 1, on our way to a discussion about a in the Old Testament, one we may not know a lot about, Melchizedek. But before we talk about Melchizedek and how he might help us in our conversations we've been having about the pursuit of godly character and how we are to long for it, how God desires us to be a people who are noble and virtuous and good, how God desires us to be a people who are called to righteousness. I want us to think about this important truth that we find in Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 18. And it is a statement, maybe one of the clearest statements in the Bible, of Jesus' superiority to all things. Paul, writing to the Colossians, says this, verse 15, "And he," referring to Jesus, "is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created by him and for him. And he is before all things. And in him all things hold together. He is also head of the body, the church. And he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself might come to have first place in everything." We've been talking about the pursuit of godliness all summer. And we've been looking at the lives of some men and women, some who are great examples to us of godliness, others who are not so good examples to us. But we don't want to lose this great truth. And it is this, that the pursuit of godliness is first and foremost the pursuit of the person of Jesus Christ. As Christians, we have a singular devotion to Jesus Christ. And that's really, I think, one of the things that unbelievers and those who are secular in their thinking find the most peculiar about us. It's not that we have a philosophy of doing good and helping others and turning the other cheek. They understand a philosophy of philosophy of morality. They understand pursuit of legality. That makes sense to unbelievers. What they do not understand about you as a Christian is your singular devotion to the person of Jesus Christ. That you are ready to do whatever he says. That you are ready to shape your thinking to anything he declares. That you are ready to bow before him at any moment. And we understand that he is above all things. That he is superior to every single thing in your life. And quite frankly, to the early Jews who were being invited to Christianity, this was a strange thing to think about. This was hard for them to wrap their minds around. Go with me to Matthew chapter 27.
Excuse me, Matthew 17. I'm sorry.
Matthew 17, verses 1 through 8. Some of you will recognize this. This is Peter and James and John on the Mount of Transfiguration. And Jesus has not only there to show them a glimpse of his glory, what he looks like in his full majesty. But he also receives two visitors there. Let me read verses 1 through 8. "And 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and brought them up to a mountain by themselves. And
he, Christ, was transfigured before them.
And his face shone like the sun.
And his garments became as white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them talking with him. Of course, verse 4, Peter is a little bit confused about what's going on here. This is what Peter wants to do. Verse 4, and Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Yeah, he's never seen anything like this. If you wish, I will make three tabernacles here. One for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah.
This is really quite naive, and I'm sort of chuckling because
Peter doesn't quite understand what's happening here. While he was still speaking, verse 5, this is where God clears it up for Peter. While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. And when the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were much afraid. And Jesus came to them and touched them and said, arise and do not be afraid. And lifting up their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. This is a pretty profound truth.
And you can write this in your notes. Jesus,
he is superior to Moses and the law. Jesus is superior to Elijah and the prophets. Moses and Elijah are there to pay homage to Christ. Because Christ is superior to them. He's not only superior, he's superior in all things. He is superior to Moses. He is superior to the law. He is superior to Elijah. And he is superior to the prophets.
Stay in the book of Matthew and go to chapter 12.
Verses 3 through 8. See another thing that Jesus is superior to. And this too is equally surprising to the Jews of Jesus' day. When they probably are believing there's nothing superior to Moses,
there's nothing superior
to Elijah, certainly nothing human, only God and God alone. Verse 3, they're having a debate about the Sabbath and what you can do on the Sabbath and what you can't do on the Sabbath, and they've created a lot of man-made regulations about what you do on the Sabbath and don't do on the Sabbath, and so they're having a debate with Jesus. And so Jesus says this, beginning in verse 3, but he, Christ, said to them, have you not read what David, how he entered the house of God and they ate the consecrated bread, which was not lawful for him to eat, nor for those with him, but for the priest alone? Or have you not read in the law that on the Sabbath the priests in the temple break the Sabbath and are innocent? But I say to you that something greater than the temple is here. But if you had known what this means, I desire compassion and not a sacrifice, you would not have condemned the innocent. For the Son of Man, he's superior to Moses. He is superior to Elijah. He is superior to the law of Moses. He is superior to all the prophets' declarations. He is superior to the Sabbath. And to give you just an example of how this works, in Acts chapter 10 is where Peter has this vision of a giant cloth being lowered down from heaven. And in this cloth are all manner of beasts. And many of them have been labeled by the law of Moses to be unclean, and you can't eat them. And so as the cloth is being lowered, Peter is given a challenge to eat them. Acts chapter 10, verse 13, and a voice came to him, Peter, arise, Peter, kill and eat. And Peter said, by no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything unholy and unclean. And again a voice came to him a second time, what God has cleansed, no longer consider unholy. And this happened three times. And immediately the object was taken up into the sky. Jesus is superior to the dietary laws as an example of his superiority to all things. The pursuit of godliness is first and foremost the pursuit of the person of Jesus Christ. That is what animates us. That is what drives us. That is what drives our devotion, inspires us, is the person of Jesus Christ. We are in love with Jesus of Nazareth. And we can't wait to do what he says. We can't wait to bow the knee. We are eager to give and to pursue and to sacrifice. He is above every single thing in your life. There is nothing in life that is superior to him. Well, I wanted to read this because Melchizedek is going to give us another way Jesus is superior. It's pretty important. It's a pretty important way. Jesus is the superior high priest. He is a superior priest. And before we talk about his story in Genesis chapter 14, in fact, you can go ahead and make your way there. Let's turn to Genesis chapter 14 while we'll spend most of our remaining time today. I want to just say a word about a priest. You know, I bet if I asked you to give me a synonym for a priest, we get lots of different words. You know, some people think of a priest as maybe a pastor, a minister, some sort of holy person. I want to make sure you have a clear vision in your mind of what the Bible means when it refers to a priest, and specifically a high priest. So what were the duties of a priest? In the Old Testament, what did a priest actually do? What were their functions? And so really the best way to think of them first and foremost is that a priest is a mediator. Now, you know what a mediator is. That's a go-between. That's someone who's kind of being the go-between. Same way that you might have a mediation with two people who are in a dispute over a lawsuit, and they might hire a mediator. And of course, they spend a lot of time, both sides, don't they, jockeying to see who's going to be the mediator. Because it's a pretty important thing. If you're in a lawsuit with somebody and you're going to mediate, you have a mediator who's going to decide the matter, you spend a lot of time arguing over who the mediator is going to be. Pretty important function. And in the Old Testament, they spend most of their time offering sacrifices. They are the one whom God has approved to bring the sacrifice before the altar, to cut the throat of the sacrifice, to allow the blood to be sprinkled on the altar, and to offer that sacrifice on behalf of the person who brought it. So in Old Testament times, if you brought a sacrifice to the temple in Jerusalem for Passover, or if you brought it for some other festival, if you were coming to the temple, he's the go-between. And the sacrifices weren't just for sin. Sometimes a family who had a wonderful, marvelous blessing would come to the temple with a sacrifice. And so they would ask the priest, offer this as a sign of our thanksgiving to God for having done this for us. So there were sin sacrifices. There were thanksgiving sacrifices. There were peace sacrifices. Parties who had been in a dispute with each other, and they had finally reached a reconciliation, they would often come together and give to the priest the peace offering. And sometimes it was an animal. Sometimes it was a goat, a lamb. Sometimes it was a dove, depending on where you were in the economic strata. If you were the poorest of poor, God would allow you to bring a much less expensive sacrifice, like a turtle dove. Or it was grain. Or it was first fruits of your farm. And the priest was the one who came in and made the sacrifice before God on your behalf. So with that in mind, I want to introduce to you the person of Melchizedek. And he's pretty important, because even though we know almost nothing about him, we are told something pretty peculiar in the New Testament. That Jesus Christ is a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. What does that mean? That's what we're going to explore this morning. What does it mean that Jesus Christ is a high priest in the same manner in which Melchizedek was a high priest? And he serves as a mediator for you and me in that same way that Melchizedek served as a mediator as he came to God. And so before I read anything from chapter 14, I just want to set the stage. So let's kind of let you know what's going on. So before Melchizedek appears on the scene, you need to know what is happening. And so in Genesis 13, I'm not going to read this, but what's happening in Genesis 13 is that Abram and his nephew Lot are butting heads. They both have big, large herds. They decide that it's better to split because the herdsmen are fighting with each other. And so Abram, who has had some moral failures, comes to Lot, and in a sort of an act of just being magnanimous, he says to Lot, you choose which direction. If you go east, I'll go west. If you choose west, I'll go east. And Lot chooses the Jordan Valley, chooses to go east into the Jordan Valley, where you find such ungodly cities as Sodom and Gomorrah. And he leaves Abram to the west. Well, Lot heads into the valley and finds himself in the midst of a civil war. And it's not going well. In fact, the side that Lot aligns with is losing in this civil war. And as we're going to see in a moment, that goes really bad news for Lot, that this civil war is raging. So let's just set the parties. Genesis chapter 14, Lot has arrived in the valley. He finds himself in the midst of this civil war. And let's see who the parties are. It came about in the days of Amraphel, king of Shinar, Arioch, king of Elasar, Kedorlaomer, king of Elam, and Tidal, king of Gom, that they made war. So there's the kings on one side. So that first part of verse 1, that is all the kings on one side, and they are the eastern kings. They are from Transjordan. What today on your map would be the modern country of Jordan? Maybe far western Iraq? Maybe southern Syria? That's the eastern kings. That's one side of the civil. The other side of this civil war are the kings of the Jordan Valley that flows from the Sea of Galilee to the Dead Sea. Verse 2, and they made war with Bera, king of Sodom, with Bersha, king of Gomorrah, Shinab, king of Admah, and Shemeber, king of Zobim, and the king of Bela, that is Zoar. All these came as allies to the Valley of Siddim, that is the Salt Sea. By the way, that'd be the Dead Sea. Travel down, so that they are gathering in around that area to do battle, and I'll tell you why that's bad news for Lot. Because do you know what cities are around the Dead Sea? Sodom and Gomorrah, the cities where Lot is hoping to live. So he is rushed into this valley and finds himself in the midst of a civil war that not only is a civil war in which he's going to be on the losing side, but a civil war in which they're fighting it right now. So the battle is raging right where the kings of the valley live. Verse 3, this is prelude to war. All these came as allies to the valley, it says. Verse 4, 12 years they had served Kedorlaomer, but the 13th year they rebelled. So the war breaks out. So for a long time, the kings of the east, they just show up as bullies and everybody kind of obeys. And they're hanging out and they're occupying the valley. And the kings of the valley are trying to make nice with the kings of the east, but finally they decide that, you know what, we just want to take some stuff. We want to take some stuff. And in the 14th year, Kedorlaomer and the kings that were with him came and defeated the Rephaim and Ashtaroth. And it goes on to say, in Zumim and Ham and Emim and Shabbath, Kiriathim. You know what this means? This means they are just knocking off one by one all the potential allies. So the kings of the valley are sitting there with this occupying force, and this occupying force is just literally taking names and knocking off every potential ally around them. They know what's coming. You know how this strategy is going to work. Let's knock off all the outlying areas, and then we're going to take you, and there'll be no one to help. So these kings of the east are having their way with the Jordan Valley. It goes on to say that they, verse 6, that they take the Horites, and they also, which is by the wilderness, then they turn back and came to En Mishpat, that is Kadesh, and conquered all the country of the Amalekites and also the Amorites who lived in Hazaron Tamar. And the king of Sodom, and the king of Gomorrah, and the king of Admah, and the king of Bela came out. Oh boy. And they arrived for battle against him in the valley of Siddim, against Kedorlaomer, king of Elam, the title and Tidal king of Gom, and Amraphel, king of Shinar, and Arioch, king of Eleazar, four kings against five. Now the valley of Siddim was full of tar pits, and the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled, and they fell into them. But those who survived fled to their own country. Then they took all the goods of Sodom and Gomorrah, and all their food supply,
looting the cities.
And they are taking all their stuff.
And then it gets worse. Verse 12. And they also took Lot. By the way, they're taking everyone they can take as a potential slave. They are gathering up slaves and servants. They are gathering up the women. They are taking them back to the... Some of them are going to serve them there in the valley. Some of them they're sending back to their homes, their home countries. They've got control now of the valley. They are taking slaves, and they take Lot. Verse 13, then a fugitive. Somebody escaped. Somebody escaped, and they came and told Abram the Hebrew. By the way, just so you know, this is the first time in the Bible the word Hebrew is used. Do you know what the word Hebrew means? Are you interested in what it means? It means from beyond the Eber River. It's a figure of speech, really. It means beyond the river, which Abram is literally from beyond the river. Remember, he's called by God from Ur of the Chaldees to come across the Fertile Crescent into Palestine, what we today know as Israel. And so he's literally called from beyond the river. And so he's given this name, Hebrew, which means literally beyond the Eber, but that's not really what it means. It's a figure of speech. Immigrant. You know what they're calling him? They're calling Abram the immigrant. You're from someplace else. And isn't it funny that that's the name of the Jews today, the Hebrews, the people from someplace else? You're immigrants. Don't you know the Palestinians who live in modern Israel today who think that the Jews have taken all that land by force? Don't you think they love calling them Hebrews? Who came here from someplace else? And so that's literally what they're saying of Abram, the guy, but they're calling him for the first time not only a Hebrew, but they're suggesting that he has a claim. He's actually starting to get a rather substantial group of people that he is the leader of. And so they come to Abram the Hebrew. Now he was living by the oaks of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eshcol, and the brother of Aner, and those were allies with when Abram heard that his relative had been taken captive, he led out his trained men, his house, 318. So he takes a group of 318. Not great, but not bad. I mean, if you're going against war against five kings, 318's not bad, but it's not great. It's kind of in between. You might want to bring more men. But he takes 318, and look what he does. He went in pursuit as far as Dan. Now, I just want to give you a sense of what that is. That would be Abram and his band of merry men. So his clan of 318, they attack. They counterattack. And they now have the kings of the east on the run. And they have chased them 140 miles to the north. Verse 15, but he didn't stop there. And he divided his forces against them by night, he and his servants, and defeated them and pursued them as far as Hobah. By the way, that's another one. Picture what's happening here. Abram and his band of 318 men are routing the eastern kings. They are routing them. It's a little bit, those of you who are great students of World War II, it's a little bit like after D-Day and after Operation Market Garden, as the British and American forces, the Germans could not retreat fast enough. The Germans literally could not retreat fast enough to stay out of the advancing way of the advancing British and American forces. And that's what's going on here. Eastern kings are being routed so bad they cannot retreat fast enough. So God is giving Abram and his clan of 318 a marvelous, really supernatural victory over the kings of the east. And it says he divided them, pursued them as far as Hobah, which is north of Damascus, and he brought back all the goods. In other words, he gets all the loot they took. He said, yep, that's going back. And he also brought back his relative. He's probably saying to the kings of the east, I really don't want you guys coming back our way. So all that stuff you took, I'm taking that. All the slaves you took, I'm taking that. And oh, by the way, my relative Lot with his possessions and also the women and the people, they're all going back with you. And I think the eastern kings at that point were like, take it. Just leave us alone. I think they're envisioning this wild band of 318 men chasing them all the way back into deep into the heart of what is the territory. Take it. Just leave us. Marvelous victory. Huge, great, marvelous victory. Then we get to the part that I really want to talk about. And that is beginning in verse 17.
Abram is returning home. And he is met by two kings when he returns. One is the king of Sodom, and one is a king we don't know anything about. Never met him before. Melchizedek. Then after verse 17, then after his return from the defeat of Kedorlaomer, and the kings who were with him, the king of Sodom went out to meet him in the valley of Shaveh. That is the king's valley. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. Now he was a priest of God Most High. And he, that's Melchizedek, blessed him, that's Abram, and said, "Blessed be Abram of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. Blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hands." He, that's Abram, gave him, Melchizedek, a tenth of all the land. And the king of Sodom said to Abram, "Give the people to me." So this is his second encounter. Now the next king steps in, king of Sodom, and says, "Give the people to me and take the goods for yourself." And Abram said to the king of Sodom, "I have sworn to the Lord God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, that I will not take a thread or a sandal thong or anything that is yours, lest you should say, I have made Abram rich. I will take nothing except what the young men have eaten and the share of the men who went with me, Aner, Eshcol, and Mamre. Let them take their share." So I want to talk about these two encounters. One with the king of Sodom, one with the king of Salem, Melchizedek. Very, very different encounters. As we think about what it must mean for Jesus Christ to be a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. So these two kings both come and make a suggestion or make a declaration over Abram. One, he accepts. And that is the acceptance of the blessing of the king from Salem. Melchizedek comes and says, "You are blessed of the God Most High. You are the possessor, who is the possessor of heaven and earth. You are blessed, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hands." He is here to acknowledge that the victory Abram has just had is because of God. And Abram wants to acknowledge that the victory is because of God. Needs to make us offering. He needs to make a sacrifice. He needs to make a declaration to God. God has him in order, and God has always a chosen priest. Come and make that declaration. And this is very strange. So that this man we've never met before, in a book like Genesis that is filled with genealogies, that is filled with family histories, that is filled with ancestral lists. I mean, I just read it. You saw the way I tortured some of these names. There's nothing. Genesis just filled with names. But when Melchizedek comes up, we don't know anything about his family, where he came from. We know he's from Salem, and that's where we get that word Jerusalem. Salem, Jerusalem. So he's by the king of Jerusalem. What will become Jerusalem, the city of David, the city of Zion. But all we know is this, that Abram acknowledges that he is a proper high priest. Abram knows who Melchizedek is. He knows enough to know. Want to make an offering to the God Most High, and you want that offering to be acceptable in the eyes of the God Most High, Melchizedek is who makes that offering on your behalf. He gladly accepts his blessing. So under Melchizedek of Salem, the first thing I want you to know, number one, Abram accepts the blessing from this high priest. He acknowledges that there is one who is closer to God than him. And that's really strange for those of us who read the book of Genesis, because if you read the book of Genesis, really starting from Genesis chapter 12 on, this seems like God's entire focus is on who? Abram. And maybe there's nobody else out there that God is dealing with. There's nobody else out there God is using. And yet here we see this man shows up who is closer to God than Abram. And we see that and we know that because Abram willingly accepts the blessing from him and he willingly makes an offering to him. It says that he gives a tenth of all at the end of verse 3. I bet the king of Sodom. Excuse me, that's our stuff you're giving away there. I'm sure Abram said to him, well, you know, it used to be your stock, and I chased these guys for 240 miles. And he gives a tenth. It's where we get the word tithe, which means tenth. And he gives a tenth of all the loot as a thanksgiving offering to God for giving them victory over the king. And who, what priest do you make it through? You make it through Melchizedek. That's who you make it through. So number one, the first thing we see is that he accepts the blessing from Melchizedek. The second thing we see is that he pays the offering to Melchizedek. He fully acknowledges Melchizedek's priesthood. Now, one thing I don't want you to miss about this is that there's a priesthood coming later. Levite priesthood. Some of you are familiar with that. Read the Bible. Levites are. Abram's going to have a son, Isaac. Isaac's going to have a son, Jacob. Jacob is going to have 12 sons, one of whom which is Levi. And God says the Levites are the priests. Now, I just want to make this small point, but it's a pretty profound one. This means Melchizedek's priesthood is superior to the Levites. It comes first. It's first in time. It is first in position. He is a priest of the Most High God that Abram acknowledges as a priest of the Most High God before the Levites are even born. They're still one, two, three generations away. They're not even here yet. They're not even thought of in the mind of Abram yet, who hasn't even had a son yet, by the way. Melchizedek's priesthood is superior, and we see that Abram acknowledges that. What about Bera of Sodom? Well, he has a declaration to make too. I'll just remind you what it was. Look at verse 21. I'm sure the king of Sodom is watching Abram give away a tenth of all of his stuff. He's thinking, okay, I got to stop this before Abram gives all my stuff away. So he makes an offer. And he really wants to make it sort of a blessing. So he kind of offers a blessing to Abraham too. He says, excuse me, not Abraham. He's Abram right now. He will be Abraham soon. He says, Abram, verse 21, he says, give the people to me. In other words, give me the slaves. Give me the people that took his slaves. Give me the women. And you can keep all the stuff for yourself. There's my blessing to you. Abram rejects that blessing. He said, I'm not the least interested in your blessing. He said, I'm watching what's going on in your city. I've seen what's going on in your city. I've seen the debauchery that goes on in Sodom. I've seen the debauchery that goes on in the perversity that goes on in Gomorrah. And I'm not the least bit interested in your blessing. So he rejects the blessing, Bera. And the second thing is he won't even accept any tribute. He says, I will not even take, verse 23, I will not take a thread or a sandal thong of yours. I want nothing from you. He wants the blessing from Melchizedek.
He does not want anything from
the king of Sodom. Which raises the most important question before we gather before the Lord's table this morning. I think it's really important, really great to kind of study this before we take the Lord's Supper today. In what way is Jesus Christ a priest like Melchizedek? Go to Hebrews chapter 5. You know, if it wasn't for Hebrews chapter 5, and if it wasn't for Hebrews chapter 7, we wouldn't know a lot about Melchizedek. I think we learn more about Melchizedek from Hebrews chapter 5 and 7 than we do from Genesis chapter 14. But let me read this, beginning in verse 5 of Hebrews chapter 5. Talking about Jesus Christ, the writer of the book of Hebrews says this. He says, so also Christ did not glorify himself so as to become a high priest, but he who said to him, thou art my son, today I have begotten thee. So he's quoting from Psalm 110. Just as he says also in another passage, thou art a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek.
So Melchizedek is mentioned in two places in the Bible. He's mentioned in Psalm 110. And we're told that the Messiah
will be a high priest in the But he's also mentioned here in Hebrews chapter 5. In the days of his flesh, he offered up both prayers, talking about Christ, in the day of Christ when he was alive on the earth, he offered up both prayers and supplications with loud cry and tears to the one able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his piety. Although he was a son, having been made perfect, he became to all those who obey him the source of eternal salvation, being designated by God as a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. Well, the references don't stop there. Go to chapter 7. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham as he was returning from the slaughter of the kings, and blessed him, to whom also Abraham appointed a tenth part of his spoils, was first of all, by the translation of his name, king of righteousness. That's what Melchizedek, and we'll see also Salem means peace. So he's the king of righteousness and peace. He's the king of righteousness, and then also king of Salem, which is the king of peace. Without father. In other words, he's pointing out, we don't know where Melchizedek came from. Without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, made like the Son of God, he abides the priest perpetually. Now observe how great this man was to whom Abraham the patriarch gave a tenth of the choicest spoils. Those indeed of the sons of Levi who received the priest's office have commandment in the law to collect a tenth of the people, that is, from their brethren. These are descended from Abraham. But the one whose genealogy is not traced from them collected a tenth from Abraham. In other words, he came first. Notice what the writer of Hebrews is saying. Yeah, you guys do all this because of the Levitical law. Abraham didn't have the law of the Levites. Yet he did it with Melchizedek. In other words, there's a high priest above even the Levites. Verse 7, but without any dispute, the lesser is blessed by the greater. So Abraham's the one. Lesser Abraham is blessed by the greater Melchizedek. And in this case, mortal men receive tithes, but in that case, one receives them of whom it is written that he lives on. And so to speak, through Abraham, even Levi, who received tithes, paid tithes, for he was still in the loins of his father when Melchizedek lived. So I want to point out two things about Jesus' priesthood. In what way is Jesus a superior high priest? Well, number one, you can put this in your notes. Jesus is a superior high priest in position. He is first in time. Just like Melchizedek was first in time before the Levites, Jesus is first in time in his high priesthood. In John chapter 8, Jesus is having a debate. And the debate that is not going well for the Pharisees as they are arguing about the Messiah and who the Messiah is. And then Jesus says this, John chapter 8, verse 58, Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am. They took that news so well because in the next verse, they picked up stones to throw at him. They knew what Jesus was saying. They knew exactly what he was saying. He was saying, standing before you in the person of Jesus Christ is one who is superior to Moses, superior to Elijah, superior to Abraham, superior to the Levitical law, superior to your dietary laws, superior to the Passover lamb. I am all that in one, he is saying. I am. They knew he was going to be taken. And that was blasphemy, so they tried to kill him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am. Jesus is a superior high priest for you in position because he is before them all. He's also superior high priest in practice. Jesus is a superior high priest in practice. You say, well, what way? Well, you know, let's think about the Levite priests for a moment. They had tough lives. Let me tell you what their life was like. You think about this today as you were taking communion. Their life was continually involved in offering sacrifices. The law of Moses had daily sacrifices. Would come with their sheep and their goats, and they would have to slaughter those and drain the blood from them and put them on the altar to burn them and offer them a sweet aroma to God in heaven. And then people would come with sin offerings on those same days. And then there were monthly offerings that came at certain days, and they had to offer those. And then there were annual offerings. So their lives are continually on an annual calendar, one continuous sin offering after another. And then on the Day of Atonement, the high priest goes into the Holy of Holies, half of the entire country. So it's a busy, busy sacrificial annual calendar. And everybody involved in it is doing this. And they go right back at it. It is a tough, continual practice. You say, why would God design it that way? for a moment to show that there's something not quite perfected about it. You have to keep coming back and doing it. You offer up the sacrifice on the Day of Atonement, you got to come back next year and do it again. You sinned this week, you brought the lamb, you offered the lamb, you got to bring another lamb next week. In other words, it is God's chosen sacrificial system, but there's something about it that's not perfected. There's something about it that's lacking completion. Jesus' sacrifice is once for all. He doesn't show up every spring during the Resurrection Sunday season and go up that hill and spend another excruciating 3 hours in the heat dying. This is a perfected high priest in practice. His sacrifice is totally perfected. It is once for all given for those who believe. So he is in the order of Melchizedek because he is first in position. And he is perfecting the high priesthood of the order of Melchizedek because he is giving the sacrifice that is once and for all. It doesn't have to be given over and over again to become a priest. And you know, a lot of Hebrews of Jesus' day really struggled with that. They had grown up their whole lives hearing what?
Well, the law of
Moses is what you have to do to please God, and you have to offer these sacrifices. You have to do them on a very strict calendar, and when that calendar's up, you got to do the next calendar, and you got to do the next month, and you got to keep doing over and over and over again. Christians and say, no, Jesus has now died once for all. That old system has been perfected in the superiority of the person of Jesus Christ. And he's the only one who could die and perfect that system.
So before we come for
communion, I just want to make two final points. So what are the implications for my daily life that Jesus is superior to all things? I mean, really, this is a serious question. I'm not trying to be glib. I'm not trying to be coy. I don't want to rush us too much through this. But really, what is the implication for your life and for my life that Jesus Christ is above all things?
He is superior to all things. He is superior to the
law. He is superior to the sacrificial system. He is a superior priest. He is a superior prophet. He is a superior everything. Galatians 2:20 says this, I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. Jesus is superior to me. I know we don't like saying that. I don't think we like admitting that. I don't think we like the idea that we can put ourselves under the subjugation of another. It doesn't come easy to us as humans, does it? It really doesn't come easy to us as Americans. I have rights, I have liberties, I have freedoms. I am to place myself under the complete subjugation of Christ. Listen, if Jesus Christ is superior to Moses, he's certainly superior to me. If Jesus Christ is superior to Elijah, he is certainly superior to me. If he is superior to the law and the Sabbath and the dietary laws and the Levitical priesthood, he is certainly superior to me. And I tell you what, beloved, that has deep, deep implications. Deep implications for your life and my life. You know what it means? There is no sacrifice. No sacrifice is too much for the one who is superior to me. No sacrifice is too much.
None.
Whatever he asks of me,
it's not too much.
Whatever manner of death I might have to die on, whatever inconvenience comes my way, it is not too much. Why? Because he's superior to me. Matthew 16:24. Then Jesus says to his disciples, if anyone wishes to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. I tell you what, beloved, we really struggle with this, don't we? Let's just be honest with each other this morning. There are things that we think are too much of an inconvenience to serve Christ. There are fears that overcome us. There's inconveniences we don't want to be put to. There's time we don't want to give. There's effort we don't want to make. Because we pay lip service to the idea he is superior to us, but when it comes time to put that into practice, I struggle, you struggle together. Because we like to be in charge, don't we? We like to be the boss of ourselves. We like to be able to command those things. And I would submit to you that this is a conversation the church in America better start having really quick. Because we are presiding over a complete collapse of Western culture, including Christian culture. And I think it's time for us to start seriously asking Jesus Christ, am I in complete submission to you? Am I really treating you like you are superior to me in all things? Or are there sacrifices I'm just not willing to make? Now I'm going to challenge all of you. Jesus gave us some pretty clear commands. I mean, they're not vague. They're not ambiguous. They're not wishy-washy. He says one of his last commands to the church is, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. Now, we as here at Calvary Bible Church are getting much more serious about that making disciples thing. Starting next Sunday night at 5:30. Now, I don't know what you're doing next Sunday night at 5:30. I don't know what is even on the calendar. But this is a great opportunity for one of two things to happen. Either for you to come and be discipled or for you. Discipling, by the way, happens with other people. You can't disciple an unbeliever. You can evangelize an unbeliever. You can share the gospel with an unbeliever. You can't disciple an unbeliever. He says, go and make disciples. That's other believers. Growing them, encouraging them. So on next Sunday night at 5:30, we start our next discipleship workshop. Yeah, some of you are going, yeah, but Pastor, I know all that stuff. Then come and help disciple those who don't know. Or you're saying, Pastor, I really don't know all that stuff. Then come and be discipled. Now, is there anything sacred about 5:30 on Sunday afternoon? There isn't. But I would say to every one of you here, if you're not going to come and help disciple others or be discipled that time, when are you doing it? Because this is not an option. This is not an option. And I would say this very seriously to every person here. If your life is such that you cannot commit to that at that particular time and that particular day, then my serious, heartfelt question to you is, when are you doing it? Because not doing it is not an option for someone who understands that Jesus Christ is superior to them. Not doing it is not on the list of options for someone who is born again, saved, following Jesus Christ with their whole heart. It's just not an option to not do it. So I would encourage you, and listen, I know the list is long of the sacrifices you have to make to do this. Make the sacrifice. I know the lions sometimes kick off at 4:00. Miss them. By the way, you're not missing anything. They're just bad. I mean, if you guys were all New England Patriots fans, it'd be a little different. But I think you get my bigger point. Make the sacrifice. But Pastor, I can't drive that late at night. Ask someone to drive you. My back starts to hurt. Get up and walk in the back of the room. Make the sacrifice. My kids might have to go, then take them for a walk and then come back. Make the sacrifice. And all I would say to you is, if you don't want to make the sacrifice next Sunday night at 5:30 to come and be part of a discipleship workshop, my only question is, when are you doing it? Because not doing it is not an option. Not if you really believe that Jesus Christ is superior. Because he has said so clearly, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. That is not vague. It's not ambiguous. It's pretty clear. And we've got to get about it, folks. We've got to get about it. Because I think the church in America is not treating Jesus like he's superior. We're treating him like he's superior some of the time. But not all the time. So with that in mind, let's spend a few moments in prayer before. Well, Lord, I thank you so much for such a great Master. Oh, you have given us such a great Savior. He is marvelous in every way. He is perfect in every way. He always knows what to say. He always knows what to tell us to do.
He is always there when we need Him. He is not lacking in any good thing. We are just so blessed that we can call Jesus Christ our Lord.
And we can call Jesus Christ our Master. Forgive us, Father, when we sometimes don't listen. Forgive us, Lord, when we sometimes partially obey, but not wholeheartedly. Forgive us, O Lord, when we let other priorities take over. We let other things have first place. Forgive us that we will not allow you to be superior at all times, because you are certainly worthy of it. We could not have a greater God than you. So, Lord, we ask you to keep us close. Keep us close to you. Rebuke us gently when we wander. Fill our hearts with eagerness to serve. Give us a hunger for discipleship, whether it be to come and disciple others or whether it be to come and be discipled ourselves. And help us to chase that with all of our strength, all of our might, all of our heart, all of our soul, to your glory. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's stand together and sing as the deer before we partake of communion. Let's stand and sing as the deer. You will find the words in today's bulletin. Please be seated. When we begin communion, Brian, would you be kind enough to dismiss Rose on this side, and I will dismiss Rose on this side. So come lead us in communion.
I know we have a lot of visitors this morning, so I'd like to explain a little bit about our communion. We do practice open communion here, so if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, we invite everybody to partake. If you're not a believer, or if you're not in good standing with the Lord, we ask that you not partake. How we do it here is they're going to dismiss you, come up row by row, and we ask you not to queue up. We don't want people too close this time. We also have covers over the communion cups, just so people won't breathe on your cough in your communion cups. So you'll take it off and just put it aside and take it back to your seat. And you'll notice that there's two communion cups there. There's one below, and below is the bread. And the other one is cup two, you took it apart. And then partake together as I go through the service. So the first thing is we'll have you come through row by row and get it, and then we'll sit back and then we'll service. But before we dismiss, I just want to also take a moment for us to think about getting our hearts right before the Lord. You know, whenever I come to the communion table, and I start to consider my unworthiness of him, it often causes me to want to go to prayer and confession. But before we do that, just a few verses that would fit well for us today as we prepare our hearts for that. That comes from Hebrews 4. It says, seeing then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus Christ,
Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold
fast our confession.
For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are,
yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly or confidently
to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in our
time of need. Let's take a few moments and go before the Lord in private prayer, and then I'll break in. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be here today. We are so thankful that you demonstrated your love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We are at our complete worst. We are living in sin.
Jesus came to the cross,
sacrificed his body, and shed his blood for us.
Oh, what
a sacrifice. You met that need that we could never meet by having that perfect Lamb of God spill his blood in our place to take all of our sins upon him so we could be completely forgiven.
Oh, what a wonderful thing.
Also this morning, we, Lord, as we come before your throne, many thoughts perhaps convicted us as the Holy Spirit worked in us. And it's so wonderful to think about 1 John 1:9, where it says, confess our sin. He is faithful and just to forgive us of all of our sins. And he will cleanse us of all unrighteousness.
How wonderful it is to be
forgiven, to be cleansed, that we come before your throne and we worship you in our whole being. We praise you and thank you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Men, if you would start bringing the rolls through at this time. bread after our reading. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Amen. I think we have one more song before our benediction. Stand together and sing the doxology. Stay right here.
Praise God from whom all things flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavens.
And then a benediction to send us out today comes from 1 Thessalonians 5. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless until the coming of